everyone. Welcome to Sunday morning worship on Sunday, the 22nd of November. Next week, we start with Advent. Crazy to think that we're already there. But this morning, what we're going to do is we're going to go through Psalm chapter 51 together. We've been in the Psalms for the last 3 weeks. But just before we get there, I just want to explain to you what you're about to see over these next few minutes. If you are unaware, Shayla has been away in the hospital the last few days. Should be home hopefully Monday or Tuesday. But with that means I've kind of lost my partner in crime who edits all of these videos and puts things together. And so I'm kind of doing the best that I can this morning. But because of that, I've actually had to cheat a little bit. And so I'm stealing a worship package that we did back in I think it was in April, and Jordan led worship that morning. I'm just taking that video and I'm putting it in with this video because, frankly, I don't have the skills by myself to be able to do all this. And I'm really, of course, I'm eagerly waiting for Shayla to come home. And, you know, the giftings that she has are very, very special, and I'll be excited for her to be back to help with some of those things as well. So, you're going to have to bear with us a little bit here this morning if the quality of the video or the audio isn't great. In the next couple of weeks, I hope it should be. All of our tech stuff has been gotten, and Monday we're going to finish everything up, and then all we're waiting for is the internet to come get hooked up. It's all trenched and ready to be put in, and then we should be able to live stream things through the soundboard. And again, I have to figure that out this week, but hopefully the next two Sundays that we go virtual here will be much, much better quality, and I hope feel more like as if you were able to come on a Sunday morning to the church. But for today, for this Sunday anyway, it's very weird because it's Saturday right now where I'm filming, but I'm trying to be in the mindset of Sunday. So hopefully you can just be patient with us here in this week. I know this is not exactly what we were hoping for. We're eager to be in person, but as we met as a board, we just felt that over these next few weeks, we need to evaluate, see what's happening in our community, and see how we can help contain the spread of what's been going on. And I know everyone's at a different perspective of what they think and what should be done, and we can certainly appreciate that there's different ways to view this. But this is the decision that we made as a group that we think is what's best for you guys and all those who call Banff Park Church their home. And so that's where we're at. So I hope that this morning you are encouraged, challenged, that you feel connected to this local body, even though, again, it's a little bit different now. But I keep trying to have perspective and remind myself that at least we have the technology available to us to be able to do this. From my perspective, preaching to a camera is no fun. I have no idea if you're with me, if you're tracking, if you've already fallen asleep on your couch in your pajamas. I have no idea. But I'm thankful that we can still connect. And tomorrow morning, for those of you, that we'll be able to watch this together and we'll be able to sing together, even though we're in our own homes, but that we'll be unified with the same purpose. And so I'm excited about that. So let me just pray as we begin, and then Jordan's going to come back from in April and lead us in a few songs together, and then we're going to open Psalm 51 together. So let's pray. God, thank you for the avenues that are available to us to be able to worship together in this way. God, we do pray that our community would fight hard for the cases that have been coming up, and that it would reverse and that it would go down, and that we would be able to gather together with safety in our building and worship together. We know that being in person is far greater, but at the same token, we're reminded that many in the world are not able to meet together the way that we have been for so many years. And so we just pray that even in these few weeks again, that we would be reminded of the blessing and the privilege of living where we live. God, would you be at work this morning in our hearts as we sing and as we open scripture together? Show us what you would have us learn and how you would impact our hearts. God, we love you. go with us this morning here as we open scripture together in a few minutes. And as we sing now, we just pray that you would receive glory and honor. Amen. All right, so I'm not sure how the transitions are going to go for these videos, but we'll do our best. So it'll be time to sing now, so you can, I think Jordan's going to ask you to stand, and you just do whatever you feel comfortable in your own home, and we'll sing together.
Thank you. The song is a good one for me to be singing right now, and I'm not sure how many of you might be thinking the same thing, but I would really, really highly recommend you listen to the words of this song. And it's okay if you can't sing it today, because I think sometimes you just can't sing these things. But it's where the rubber hits the road, is songs like this, sometimes like this. And all the stars may
Let's read through this together here this morning. You can flip to Psalm 51 if you're not already there. And this kind of concludes our 3 weeks through the Psalms. We looked at Psalm 23, the Lord is our shepherd and our host, and that beautiful metaphor, probably the most well-known verses in Scripture. Then we looked at Psalm 139 and the personal aspect of God and how He created us and how He has made us unique and with purpose and meaning. And then also that David ended the psalm the same way, even though God already knows us intimately, even though God has created us, knows our thoughts and our just everything about us, David invites God back in and says, you know, examine my heart and see if there's anything wrong in me that should not be there, and then take it away. And that, of course, should be our prayer too, is that God would constantly be revealing what's happening in my attitude and my heart. Is God already knows me, but God, would you reveal to me what shouldn't be there? And then we finish now with Psalm 51, a psalm of confession. Man, I have lots I want to say about this, but I think we need to read it first, get a little context, and then clarify some things. So let me just read to you from Psalm 51. It says this: Have mercy on me, O God, according to your steadfast love. According to your abundant mercy, blot out my transgressions. Wash me thoroughly from my iniquity and cleanse me from my sin. For I know my transgressions, and my sin is ever before me. Against you, you only, have I sinned and done what is evil in your sight, so that you may be justified in your words and blameless in your judgment. Behold, I was brought forth in iniquity, and in sin did my mother conceive me. Behold, you delight in truth in the inward being, and you teach me wisdom in the secret heart. Purge me with hyssop, and I shall be clean. Wash me, and I shall be whiter than snow. Let me hear joy and gladness. Let the bones that you have broken rejoice. Hide your face from my sins, and blot out all my iniquities. Create in me a clean heart, O God. Renew a right spirit within me. Cast me not away from your presence, and take not your Holy Spirit from me. Restore to me the joy of your salvation, and uphold me with a willing spirit. Then I will teach transgressors your ways, and sinners will return to you. Deliver me from blood guiltiness, O God of my salvation, and my tongue will sing aloud of your righteousness. O Lord, open my lips, and my mouth will declare your praise. For you will not delight in sacrifice, or I would give it. You will not be pleased with a burnt offering. The sacrifices of God are a broken spirit, a broken and contrite heart, O God, you will not despise. Do good to Zion in your good pleasure. Build up the walls of Jerusalem. Then you will delight in right sacrifices, in burnt offerings, and whole burnt offerings. Then bulls will be offered on your altar. Now what I'm going to do here, because I'm really not sure. We have a pretty small memory card that came with this camera, and I don't know how long I have. So I'm going to try my best to follow my notes here this morning, which is unusual for me. But let me just say this about this idea of confession, right? Sometimes the sin in our hearts, we desperately don't want other people to see. And I know that me as a kid, when I read these kind of things, I shouldn't even say as a kid, even as a young adult, is as I read through these, I was terrified that God would be revealing my sin to others so that they could see it. And in that, I lost sight of what is actually happening. Is God doesn't reveal your sin so that others can see it. That's not the point. God reveals your sin in your heart so that you recognize your desperate need of Him. When we recognize that, then we confess and enter into that right relationship with God the way that He longs for us to be. And so the context for this specific psalm is found in 2 Samuel 12. And I just want to give you kind of the highlights of what happens is David, who has been a wonderful king, a man after God's own heart, has done so many wonderful things. And if you read through the kings, you see that there aren't very many good ones, but David is like the standard. And yet there's this moment in, not even a moment, a season, where David sins just all sins bad, but this just seems so awful for us. Is David is supposed to be off at war, and he's not. And he's up on the roof and of his palace, and he looks and he sees a woman bathing, and lust gives way in his heart, and he desires her. And so he, through the course of events, ends up having her brought to the palace, and he sleeps with her. And then he thinks it's good, it's done, it's over. But of course, that's not how sin works. And Bathsheba sends a message to the king, I'm pregnant. And of course, David knows he's in trouble now, because Bathsheba's husband is one of David's finest men, Uriah, fighting in the battle. And so David, again, through a series of events, calls Uriah home and tries to get Uriah to go down to his wife so that he'll sleep with her, and so that that when this baby comes, that no one will be the wiser. David's trying to cover up his sin. But Uriah, in this, I don't know if it's ironic or what, but what we see is he has more integrity than David. And he goes, no, I will not go down and be with my wife when all the men are fighting. This is not right. This is not just. And he sleeps kind of in the doorpost of the palace. And David continues to try and tries to get him drunk and all these things. And Uriah does not bend. And so Uriah goes back to battle, carrying a note from David that David has said, put Uriah where the fighting is the worst so that he dies. So not only has he had this affair and gotten this woman pregnant, but then he kills her husband. And David's now living with this sin. And so you have the prophet Nathan in 2 Samuel 12 who comes to him and through this story of a sheep, because of David's shepherding background, which we looked at a couple of weeks ago, through the story of the sheep, Nathan shows David just the wickedness and the evil in his own heart, though he doesn't put the pieces together yet. And all of a sudden, in this moment, Nathan kind of says, well, what do you think should happen to this guy in his make-believe story? And David says, that man should die. And Nathan says, you are that man. And David is exposed. And all that he's been hiding, and David should know better, just like we should, just like I should. God sees all. We looked at this last week. God knows. And yet, David tries to hide this from God, and he can't. And God exposes it to him. And so this psalm is a response, not only to that sin, but in that narrative in 2 Samuel 12 is what you have is David repents right there. And then what's really interesting is this, I want to read this in verse 13 of 2 Samuel 12. David confesses his sin and says, I have sinned against the Lord. Then Nathan says to David, the Lord has also put away your sin, you shall not die. The Lord forgives David in this moment, and this psalm is then penned after that. And as I was studying those verses in 2 Samuel 12, I came across this from John Piper, and I thought this was really good, so I want to read this. He says that the Hebrew word for put away is actually the same as pass over. And what that should do is that should remind us ahead to Romans 3, 23 to 25, where Paul writes this, for all have sinned and fall short of the glory of God and are justified by His grace as a gift through the redemption that is in Christ Jesus, whom God put forward as a propitiation by His blood to be received by faith. This was to show God's righteousness, because in His divine forbearance He had passed over former sins. In the Old Testament, when we read about this passing over of sins, this forgiving of sins, it's because all of this sacrificial system, all of it points to Jesus' blood, which will actually forgive all sins once and for all. And so, when we now, in our time, when we read back on Psalm 51, and we read about David confessing his sins, this should help us look ahead. In the Old Testament, this should help us look ahead to Jesus and recognize that all this was fulfilled. All this was finished, that Jesus was the atonement of our sins, the only acceptable sacrifice for our sins to actually be forgiven. According to Romans 10, Jesus died once for all. All sins are forgiven. And so when we read back in this moment and we see David confessing, as we're going to talk about this, we should confess too, but our confession is different. Because if you have recognized your need of Jesus, if you have declared Jesus as Lord and Savior of your life, then your sins are forgiven, past, present, and future. And so you don't need to go to God to confess sin because you need to be re-forgiven. Your sin's already been forgiven. But now there's a relational component on this side of the cross that we need to address. So the best example I can give you is with Shayla. Is at our wedding, we vowed to love each other, to choose to love each other every day until the day that we die. And so we could take advantage of that if we wanted to, right? Is if I wronged Shayla, I could go, you know what? She's got to forgive me. She promised she would. She promised she would still love me. And so I could just pretend like it never even happened, that I never said what I said or did what I did or hurt her in any way, and just she just has to forgive me. But that relationship is fractured then. And in the same way is, yes, Jesus' blood has covered all of my offenses, and so I am forgiven. I'm not going to lose my salvation because I sin against God. But the relationship does hurt. The relationship is fractured. And through confession, we can find that restoration of that relationship. And so when we read these Old Testament things, we need to think of it in its context that it's written, because it points to Jesus and it's proof that Jesus is who he claimed he was. But we also need to understand it in a slightly different context. The blood of Jesus is sufficient to forgive all sins. David's sins back then, my sins now, my son's sins in the future. It's an amazing, amazing thought. So, just as we get into this now, this is one of the seven penitential psalms. And David Kidner, a commentator, says this, and it's really beautifully put. He says, this comes from David's blackest moment of self-knowledge, yet it explores not only the depth of his guilt, but some of the farthest reaches of salvation. You know, I say this often, but God is a God of redemption. And in this specific psalm, we look at David's worst moment. And actually, he uses it for good. He uses it so that David would show everyone in the future what God's forgiveness looks like and means to him. You know, as I was thinking about this, is I would not want my worst sins to be recorded for everyone to see. Probably none of us would. And yet that shows the short-sightedness and this guard that we have in our heart that I don't want people to see that. When to David it was, through this God uses Nathan in 2 Samuel 12, but that we see the depth of God's grace and his goodness. And others can look at this and they can see hope and they can go, if God was able to forgive David, then why can't he forgive me? And that's exactly what people need to hear and what we need to show. And so we shouldn't hide things. Now, I'm not saying you broadcast all your deepest, darkest secrets. That's not the point. But the point is that we don't hide them. Because the only reason that we are where we're at right now is because of the goodness and the grace of God, despite what we have done. And we can think that it's because of all the good decisions we've made, but if the worst of all of our decisions were recorded for everyone else, you know, how would we think? Would we say, praise the Lord, that shows who I was, and now we see who I am. Still flawed, still broken, but not like that anymore. So David says, have mercy on me, O God, according to your steadfast love. Right? David cries out for mercy, but not on his own merits, but on the merits of God's love towards him. It has nothing to do with him. It has everything to do with God. There is humility in this. And that's something we always need to remind ourselves of. A.P. Ross writes, God's forgiveness is by his grace alone. I don't deserve it. I don't, not at all. And we're going to talk about what David says here in a few minutes, but basically what David says and what we should say is that if I got what I deserved, it would be hell. Because of God's grace and his goodness and his love for me, then I find forgiveness. In verse 2, we see this idea of washing. It sounds like David's comparing it to like a dirty shirt that he needs to take off and clean thoroughly. And this actually reminded me ahead to Ephesians 6, of where Paul says, put on the armor of God. And the same metaphor of clothing is used. And I can't help but think of that in that beautiful moment of that which is awful on me is I can take it off. And I can give it to God and he can wash it and make it clean. And then I can put on his armor that he has given us. What a wonderful thought that is. David says he knows his sin and his sin is ever before him. Now again, if you do a little bit of homework or even a little bit of logic reasoning, when you read through in the passage in Samuel, is that this son that is born through David and Bathsheba dies very, very young. And so what it looks like is that David lived with this unconfessed sin for probably about a year. And maybe you can relate, maybe you've been or have in the past or currently are holding on to something that you won't admit to, you won't deal with, and it just, you can't get it out of your mind and you can't stop thinking about it, and there's guilt and remorse and shame and all of those things. And that's the beauty of confession. In fact, in some ways, is if the longer we hold something in, the worse and the worse and the worse it gets, till we realize that if we had just confessed it in the first place, yes, there's still consequences, but they might have actually even been less. And we wouldn't have had to go through however long the time period was of just carrying all that guilt and shame. We could have confessed that, yes, there's consequences that we have to deal with, but then we can move forward from that. David shows us something important in verse 4. He says this, against you, you only have I sinned and done what's evil in your sight. And that seems like a very strange thing. It's like, David, you didn't sin only against God. Like, you sinned against Bathsheba and Uriah and, I mean, other people throughout this story. And at first it can seem like this is wrong. But what commentators say here is that what David is acknowledging is that ultimately his sin is against God and God alone. John Piper says it this way, what makes sin sin is that it's against God. We hurt people, but we sin against God. Is David isn't saying he didn't wrong Bathsheba, or that there weren't consequences from that, or that he probably didn't need to go and confess those things to her. What he was acknowledging is that all sin is ultimately about hurting God and sinning against him. And we hurt other people in that process, and they have to pay the consequences of our sins so often. But what David is realizing here in this moment is against you have I sinned and done what is evil in your sight. And he says, so that you may be justified in your words and blameless in your judgment. He's acknowledging that the only proper response of this is that God looks at him and judges him because his heart is showing exactly what we already know to be true, that we are desperately wicked and evil of our own, and that we desperately need the forgiveness of God. Now let's move ahead here verses 5 and 6, you know, we'll skip this for now, but you can look back to last week's sermon, right? This idea of I was brought forth in iniquity is David's just acknowledging what we talked about last week, is that sin doesn't happen to us when, you know, we're 12 years old and then all of a sudden we sin, is we have a sin problem right from the time that we're conceived. And so I encourage you to look back on last week for that. Then we end up here, so purge me with hyssop and I shall be clean in verse 7. So, again, I'm going to quote a commentary who says this: this represented the removal of sin through the shedding of blood, right? So that was the ceremonial law. Ultimately, when we read in Hebrews 9:22, we're reminded that only in Jesus' blood is salvation found. Is that all this other sacrifice was pointing to Jesus. However, I do want to deal with something in verses 10 and 11, because this is sometimes very misunderstood. We read, create in me a clean heart, O God. Renew a right spirit within me. Cast me not away from your presence and take not your Holy Spirit from me. Right? We've sung the song lots from the psalm, and I think there's value to singing it. But what we need to do is understand the context of this so that we don't make it say what it doesn't say. Does God take his spirit from somebody? Well, depends how you define this. So if you look in the Old Testament, you read about King Saul, and you see that God's spirit departs from Saul. And so some have argued that David is asking here that God not take away his kingship. The problem with this idea is that in the inscription, or the very beginning, if you read it, it says to the choir master in Psalm 51. This was actually a psalm that David penned that was then recited as a congregation. So this was a corporate thing. It wasn't an individual thing. Sung as a group of people. And so this isn't about David having the kingdom taken from him the way it was from Saul. So it seems like what David is saying is, don't take your Holy Spirit from me. Again, this idea of salvation. So for us, we need to understand this from a New Testament perspective. Our theology needs to be based on the whole narrative of Scripture, not just one moment. Is as we go through the New Testament, what we learn in Ephesians is that we are given the Holy Spirit as a deposit, guaranteeing our inheritance. It's a guarantee, it's a deposit, it's given to us. Never in the New Testament do we read about the Holy Spirit being taken away. David's plea is that he wouldn't lose the Holy Spirit. And through the rest of the psalm and the context, what you see is that David's simply saying, I don't deserve forgiveness. I don't deserve your love and your mercy and your kindness. I don't, but he's pleading with God in his steadfast love to do exactly that. Because of his love, not because of David. And so he's saying, don't take your Holy Spirit from me, in this realization of how serious his sin was. Not in this worry that he was going to lose his salvation. He was worried about losing his intimacy with God. And so for us, in the New Testament context, is when we read that, is it's this relational thing again. It's God, don't turn away from me in this moment. And God never does. God is always there with us, but that relationship can get hurt. And for us to then go back and say, God, I don't deserve you to restore me back to you, because I've hurt you so many times. But in your goodness and your mercy, restore to me that relationship the way that you intend it to be. And what a beautiful thing that can be. Trevor Longman writes it this way. He says, David wants to feel the joy of a healthy relationship with God again. He desires a steadfast and willing spirit in order to keep him from sinning again. And he knows that in his own power, he will continue to sin. But with the Holy Spirit, with the Holy Spirit's leading, and that's just as true of David back then as it is of us now, is we can say, Holy Spirit, lead me, and we can submit to the Holy Spirit. And then we won't sin when we submit to the Holy Spirit, because we will do what's right and good because of his work. But the problem is sometimes we ignore. Sometimes we don't listen to. Sometimes we choose our own selfish desires instead. So again, I need to confess my sin before God. Not because Jesus' sacrifice on the cross wasn't sufficient. It was. But my relational status needs to be restored to him. David moves on into verse 13. And he says, not only does he want to be restored to a right relationship with God for his sake, but he also wants this so that he can declare it to others. And again, this is what I was saying about his worst moments recorded in the scripture. And yet he says, God, well, let me read. Then I will teach transgressors your ways, and sinners will return to you. My tongue will sing aloud of your righteousness. My mouth will declare your praise. That's parts of 13, 14, and 15. Is that should be our prayer, is that in our worst moments, when we know we don't deserve anything, we don't deserve forgiveness, we don't deserve grace, we don't deserve mercy, and yet God extends it to us, we can then declare that as loud as possible and say, look at me, broken, not worthy, and yet God grants me mercy, and he offers that mercy to you, regardless of the situation that you find yourself in. Everything is meant to be pointed back to Jesus for the sake of the gospel so that others would see that they can be forgiven of their sins. What a beautiful thing. But then he says this, and I just want to clarify here. Right as he says, verse 16, you will not delight in sacrifice, or I would give it. You will not be pleased with the burnt offering. The sacrifices of God are a broken spirit, a broken and contrite heart, O God, you will not despise. And so some have argued here that David is anti-Old Covenant, and that he is recognizing already that the obedience of obeying that Old Covenant sacrificial system is nothing, and so no one else should have observed it. But all that's just taking one or two verses way out of context, because the psalm ends with, then bulls will be offered on your altar. Right? It's clear, the context is David's heart. And he's saying, God, I'm not just gonna sacrifice while my heart is broken, while my heart is filled with wickedness. I'm going to confess. I'm going to deal with those things first. And then, after I've dealt with the inward, then I will go and externally do what you have called me to do. Now again, us in the new covenant, we don't sacrifice. Why don't we sacrifice? Because Jesus sacrificed once for all. David was sacrificing because it pointed to Jesus. It was an act of obedience that somehow they knew that God would forgive sin completely. We on this side of the cross have seen that already. And so when Jesus comes in the Sermon on the Mount, he deals with that motivation. And with the Pharisees over and over and over, he deals with the inward rather than just what comes out. We can fake a lot of things, and we can have people really fooled. But what's in our heart, God sees it and God knows it. And we can't fake it for him. And so we need to confess what is internal so that what we do external actually has value and meaning. Right? Like those of you who are parents, you know this to be true, is when you... You know, I remember when I was a kid is you'd fight with your brother or whatever and your parents would say, apologize, and be like, sorry, and you'd walk off, right? That means nothing. Because, you know, it doesn't come from a place of sorrow and repentance and realizing what you did was wrong and wanting to restore that and fix it. I'll just say it. It doesn't mean anything. But when your child has hurt you and they realize it, and they come to you with repentance, and they recognize what they did was wrong, and it hurts you, man, nothing. It's just so meaningful, because you realize in that moment they recognized, and they actually mean what they say. And that's true of all of our relationships, is you can say all you want, I'm sorry, but if you're not sorry, people see it. People know it, and it means nothing. So what is internal for David, right, is a broken and contrite heart. When he recognizes that, then he will then sacrifice, because his inward has been proper. His motivation is now right. D. Kidner again points this out. He says, what David is emphasizing is that the best of gifts is hateful to God without a contrite heart. The heart. Why do we do what we do? if it's out of obligation and duty, not out of love and a response to God's mercy, then it means nothing, no matter how good it might be or how good we might perceive it to be. I just want to close looking at these last two verses, but I just want to read a quote from Collins who points this out just so beautifully. He says this, so I'm going to read it. It's a little bit of a longer quote. He says, as the psalm closes, it enables the worshipers to see the relationship between their own spiritual health and the well-being of the whole body of God's people, Zion. That is, each member is linked to all the others in a web of relationships, and together they share in the life of God as it pulses through the whole body. Thus, each member contributes to, or else detracts from, the health of the whole. The ideal Israel is a community of forgiven penitence, faithfully embracing God's covenant and worshiping Him according to the rites He appointed. This is the community that can bring light to the whole world. And this is just as true in today's world with the church. We're broken individuals. But when we gather together with unity and purpose, what we offer to the world to see is that it's not about me, but it's about God. And I can get along with people. Not only can I get along with people, I can love them desperately, despite that we have differences in all kinds of areas. But when we do not invest in that body, in that community, in that church, the church isn't whole. Just like Paul says in 1 Corinthians when he's writing about all the spiritual gifts, he says, we're one body. And if my leg decides to up and leave, my body suffers for it. If my arm decides not to do what it's called to do, then my body suffers for it. And the church suffers when all of us don't band together and use the spiritual gifts that God has given to us for the good of the body and the broader community, this town of Banff that we live in. I really struggled with whether I should say this, but I think I should. Is in today's world, right now, COVID has really distracted many people from what our mission is as a Christian. I'm not saying it's not important. I'm not saying that there aren't things that we need to explore and information that we should be getting and all these things. I'm not. Those are still important. But they've never been as important as the mission of the gospel. Nothing ever has been. But unfortunately, COVID has done that. And many have become so distracted that faith, community, the church body, working together to declare the name of Jesus has become pushed away. And we're only focused on this one singular issue. And that's a tactic of Satan to distract us from what is truly the most important thing. So I want to challenge each and every one of us. Gather together with people that differ with you, that think differently in some of these areas, and recognize that that's not what ties you together, but Jesus is. And we can, with our uniquenesses and with our differences, continue to love and serve one another the way that we have been called to do. And over these next couple of weeks here, as we have virtual service, it is a little more difficult for that face-to-face kind of thing, but I'd really challenge you, connect with people over Zoom or FaceTime or just a phone call, and show them that you love them, that you care for them, and that you want them to grow, and you want to grow, and we want to declare Jesus. And maybe we need to confess to one another some of our own feelings and thoughts that we've had, that we would be able to be rebuilt, restored. So as we end here, I just encourage you in your own family units, just to consider some of these things. Consider that when we hurt God, when we wrong God, we need to go to Him. And we need to confess those things so that that relationship can be restored. And that's true of husbands and wives and fathers and sons and fathers and daughters and mothers and sons and mothers and daughters and beyond all of that. Is all of our relationships could be stronger and could be better. And so if we have wronged somebody, to confess that wrong. think I'll leave it there. Let's pray and just know that even in this time, as we're not meeting together for the next few weeks, that you're loved and you're cared for. If you need anything, please let the office know, myself, whether you phone me or the church or whatever. It doesn't matter. If you have needs, let us know and we'll do our very best. Let's pray. God, thank you for this Psalm 51. Thank you for the reminders of what's in it, the truth that we see in it. Thank you that Jesus died on the cross so that our sins are forgiven, so we don't have to sacrifice in the old covenant way every time that we do wrong, but that we can know that the cross was sufficient for that. But help us to also know that when we hurt you, when we do what's wrong, help us to confess those things to you so that we could be in a healthy relationship with you. And God, also may that be true of one another within the body of Christ. Help us to love each other and to care for each other and to build each other up so that we as a group of people can declare Jesus to this community of Banff. God, we love you. Thank you so much for all that you're doing. Amen. We look forward to seeing you next week through this medium again. Of course, the next couple of weeks we'll be doing virtual, but it's been a pleasure to share this with you. Also want to just mention, just as we finish, that the 29th in the evening, if you go to our YouTube channel, you will see the ministerial Advent series service that we do the first Sunday of Advent every year. So that will be available on there. So all the churches have done a little bit of different things to kind of band together and to show that we're still united, that we still have purpose to declare Christ as a community. God bless. Have a wonderful week.